Good morning. Before we begin, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come and hear your word. Father, we pray that you open up our eyes to see you, open up our ears to hear you, open up our hearts to receive you. Speak to us this morning. Your servants are listening. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. This period of Lent, we are speaking on a series entitled With All Your Heart. As we go through a period of introspection these 40 days, will we all hear the call to return to God with all our hearts? Last week, Pastor Lynette spoke about an inheritance from God. God is our gracious and generous Father, and we are to give to Him from our inheritance a first fruit. The giving of first fruits is about trusting God with what we have and what He has first given us. This week, we will explore another aspect of inheritance, and the sermon this morning is entitled Imitating. And the idea is that we imitate Christ with all our heart by laying down our earthly rights because we have a heavenly inheritance. So the main idea, we imitate Christ by laying down all our earthly rights because we have a heavenly inheritance. So there are two big themes that we will explore this morning, imitating and inheritance. We have two passages to consider. The Old Testament passage is taken from Genesis 15. It speaks about God giving Abram an inheritance of a huge tract of land. The New Testament passage in Philippians 3 speaks of an even greater inheritance. Paul speaks of our citizenship in heaven. And this is a greater inheritance than any physical thing, any physical piece of land. Our heavenly inheritance is in Christ, and He alone is a real fulfillment of any promise of land. Let's read from Genesis 15 now. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Fear not, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me, for I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, Behold, you have given me no offspring, and a member of my household will be my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. This man shall not be your heir. Your very own son shall be your heir. And he brought him outside and said, Look toward heaven and number the stars if you are able to number them. Then he said to him, So shall your offspring be. And he believed the Lord and he counted it to him as righteousness. And he said to him, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess. But he said, O Lord God, how am I to know that I shall possess it? He said to him, Bring me a heifer, 3 years old, a female goat, 3 years old, a ram, 3 years old, a turtle dove and a young pigeon. And he brought him all these, cut them in half and laid each half over against the other. But he did not cut the birds in half. And when the birds of prey came down on the carcasses, Abram drove them away. As the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell on Abram. And behold, a dreadful and great darkness fell upon him. Verse 17. When the sun had gone down and it was dark, behold, a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch passed between these pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, To your offspring I give this land, from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates. The New Testament reading is taken from Philippians 3:17 to 4:1. Verse 17, Brothers, join in imitating me and keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example you have in us. For many of whom I have often told you and now tell you, even with tears, walk as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their end is destruction. Their God is their belly, and they glory in their shame, with minds set on earthly things. But our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body, by the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself. Therefore, my brothers, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm thus in the Lord, my beloved. This is the word of the Lord. The great writer Oscar Wilde once said, "Imitation is the sincerest form of flattery that mediocrity can pay to greatness." So why do we imitate something? Why do we copy something? We see that thing or person as better or greater than we are. There is some quality in that thing or that person that we desire and we aspire to. So many people imitate their idols. For example, movie stars, sports icons. They want to carry the same bags that they carry. They want to wear the same clothes or watches that they wear. I remember when I was younger, baggy jeans was all the rage because there was rappers, there's basketball stars, wore their clothes like that, and I wanted to emulate them. I wanted to copy them. If you can't identify the older ones, maybe it would be bell bottoms or big perm hair. Imitating can sometimes be bad, you know. It's estimated that the global counterfeiting industry is worth almost $1 trillion per year. To put that in perspective, that's three times Singapore's GDP. The most counterfeited item is something close to my heart: shoes. And the most imitated brand in the world, Nike. Counterfeiting is imitating without permission. However, many times imitating can be good. Imitating shows affection. Babies, children, they often imitate their parents. They imitate the words we say, the actions, mannerisms, the way we stand, our behavior. And they do it because they look up to us as role models. They love us. They want to be like us. In my home one evening, the adults were around the dining table and we were just commenting, "Wow, this virus situation, jialat man." And my 1.5-year-old, who was sitting beside us, turned and say, "Jialat, jialat." And ever since, we couldn't stop her from saying jialat. So parents, be careful what you say or how you act when you're around your children. We not only imitate our parents, we imitate people we are close to, like our significant other. And over time, you speak. And sometimes you look like your husband or your wife. Or at least your actions are like your husband's or your wife. Sometimes at the interview, we imitate the body language of the interviewer to get them to feel that we are like them. We are kindred spirits so that they will hire us. So the point is that if we do imitate, if we see that there's something worth imitating, something valuable, something noble, something that makes us closer to the ideal that we want to be or that we see. In Philippians 3:17, Paul has a big ask. He says, "Join in imitating me." Paul is so daring to ask us to imitate him. Think about it. How many of you are confident enough to tell another Christian, a brother and sister in Christ, "If you want to be more Christ-like, imitate me"? How many of us live a life worth imitating? Paul does sound daring, but actually what he's trying to say and what he's been consistently saying in all his letters is that people should imitate him as he's imitating Christ. One example is in 1 Corinthians 11, 1, and it reads, "Imitate me as I imitate Christ." This is found in both letters to the Thessalonians. Paul also issues this call to imitate him and the Lord Jesus Christ. So in all this, Paul is actually saying that the end goal is to imitate Jesus. The end goal, as he points out in our passage in Philippians 3:21, is when our lowly bodies are transformed to be like Jesus's glorious body. That is the completion of the process of imitation, when we are like Christ. If we are to imitate Christ, how do we do it? What are the practical steps involved? In Philippians, Paul contrasts two different places, two different realms, heaven and earth. In verse 19, Paul tells us, if we set our minds on earthly things, we are enemies of the cross. We are enemies of Christ. And then he goes on to contrast that our real reward, our real inheritance, our real citizenship is in heaven. So we should imitate Christ by setting our eyes heavenward, laying down any earthly things that makes us walk as enemies of the cross. Yes, this is well and good. I want to look heavenwards, but there's nothing in the text that tells me how to do it. How do I imitate Jesus in my life? Think about that, and I'll return to this later, how we imitate Christ. But now we turn to this cryptic passage in Genesis 15. While Philippians talks about a heavenly inheritance, Genesis speaks about a physical inheritance, a real inheritance of land that is granted to Abram. In Genesis 15, we read about Abram, and at that time he was childless, and God stunningly promises him two things. God said that he would have a son. And next, God promised Abram about the inheritance of land. This land that we describe is actually quite huge. It spans from the river of Egypt to the river Euphrates, and it's in the red shaded portion. And using a modern map, this land encompasses about one third of Egypt, all of the land of the nation of Israel, the nation of Jordan, or the kingdom of Jordan, Lebanon, Syria, half of Iraq, and possibly some parts of Saudi Arabia in the desert. Except during a short 40-year reign of Solomon, Israel did not control this promised piece of land. For most of its history after Solomon, Israel got smaller and smaller and smaller until the last of Judah was exiled to Babylon and there was no land left. Even after Ezra and Nehemiah returned, the land of Israel was not really theirs. It was controlled by the dominant kingdoms of Greece and subsequently of Rome. So what do we make of this land and this promise to Abraham? Is the land then this physical piece of property from Egypt all the way to Iraq? Because of how we see inheritance in our modern-day language, we acquire a slightly distorted view of Abram's inheritance. The inheritance of land was not a right to possess and own solely for his personal benefit. It was more like something that was entrusted to Abraham to use for the furtherance of God's purposes. What was Israel supposed to be? Israel was to be a light to the nations, and the land was given to Israel not for it to hoard, but to be a blessing to others. Land was given to Israel, but God is the ultimate owner of the land. He is the divine landlord. Israel was living on a super long leasehold. It's something like our 999-year lease property. And we see this in Leviticus 25. The land, while given to Israel, could not be freely bought, could not be freely sold without certain conditions. It was not like a commercial property that Israel could use as it pleased. The use of land was actually a test of covenant loyalty, whether Israel used the land to promote economic equality. Remember that the heart of God goes out to the poor. The heart of God goes out to the foreigner. The heart of God goes out to the marginalized. Jesus Christ is a fulfillment of Scripture, and all of God's promises find their fulfillment in Jesus. Jesus is the central figure of our faith. Jesus is the central figure of all the Bible. And as we seek to imitate Christ, we understand that all of Scripture, all of the Bible, is a testimony of Jesus and must point to Him. We then see that this promise of land is fulfilled by Jesus when He comes to inaugurate the kingdom of God. Jesus not only fulfills, but expands on a promise of inheritance. See, our inheritance is no longer physical. Our inheritance is no longer constructed of the dust of earth. We have no earthly city, but we look for one that is to come. This is not a New Testament conjecture, and Isaiah already foreshadows this at the end of his prophecy. He states that God is going to create a new heaven, a new earth. Therefore, as Paul declares in Philippians, our inheritance and our citizenship certainly is in heaven, and we are citizens of the heavenly kingdom. So the New Testament clearly changes this concept of inheritance of land. But what did Jesus himself have to say about the land? What did Jesus have to say about this Jewish concept that's binding all his countrymen about inheriting the land? This was such an important thing to the Jews of Jesus' time, because in their mind's eye, this land which they were supposed to inherit was controlled by the Roman Empire. They wanted it back. Jesus, in fact, does not talk about inheritance of physical land before his death. Jesus was, in fact, opposed to this idea that he was a conquering Messiah that's coming to overthrow the Romans. That's not his job. Post-resurrection, however, Jesus did say something about the land. Jesus challenges this Jewish concept of inheriting the land. After the resurrection, Jesus meets two disciples on the road to Emmaus. These two disciples could not recognize Jesus, and they were trying to explain to this backwater bumpkin all the things that this Jesus was supposed to do. Haven't you heard about Jesus? And in Luke 24:21, the two disciples said that they had hoped that Jesus was the one who would redeem Israel and set her free. See, this hope was that the nation of Israel would be finally independent and have her own land and be free from Roman rule. And Jesus quickly corrects this mistaken notion. And he says in verse 25 and 26, "O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe that all that the prophets had spoken, was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory?" And Jesus was saying that he came to suffer and die, not to liberate this piece of land and Israel, but to transcend into glory, into a heavenly place far greater than this earthly realm. And if you read the prophets, all of them point to this. This is recorded at the end of Luke, and it's important to note that Luke also wrote the book of Acts. Luke Acts is like a two-part series written by Luke to record the life of Jesus and the church. And in the first few verses of Acts, Jesus also answers a question about the inheritance of land. So in the center of this two-part series, Luke Acts, in the hinge of the writing of Luke, Jesus says a few short but important words about land. In Acts 1:6, the disciples ask Jesus again about the restoration of Israel, about this earthly kingdom, about this land that Israel was promised. "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" And Jesus responds, "It is not for you to know the times or the seasons that the Father has fixed by His own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." And Jesus is saying that this kingdom of God that He has brought is not so narrow, not so limited to this small strip around Palestine. And this kingdom is powered by the Holy Spirit himself. And this kingdom, this inheritance reaches to the end of the earth. Jesus is saying, stop focusing on the land. My inheritance is far greater. My kingdom is far greater. And you are citizens of the kingdom. Not only that, this promise is expanded from Jews only to include Gentiles, and all the people of the world now share in the promise of inheritance. And if Jesus didn't do that, none of us have the right to sit here. If Jesus didn't do that, we are doomed. In summary, Jesus didn't speak about inheritance of land before his death. But after resurrection, Jesus clarified this physical territory, this land of Palestine, is of no consequence. We are going to the world. When his disciples, when the early church caught this vision, caught the true meaning of inheritance, that is when the gospel went to the nations. In the New Testament, the physical territory of Palestine ceases to have any theological significance. The significance of inheritance is in the person of Jesus Christ himself and his kingdom. So limiting the inheritance to a physical space undermines the work of Jesus Christ on the cross. And the future of the people of God is not in that physical land we call Palestine. The future is in Christ. The future is in heaven. What we have established as a link between these two passages, Genesis 15 and Philippians 3, is that our inheritance is real. Abram was promised land, but Christ has come to fulfill this promise in an unexpected way. The promise of inheritance is real, but it's not physical. It is heavenly. It will never end. Physical things pass away. Physical things are destroyed. But our citizenship, our inheritance, is eternal and in heaven. Some of us here may have wealthy parents. Some of us may have received a large inheritance. Some of us are expecting to receive a nice, large inheritance. Maybe a bungalow, which was your family home. Maybe a trust fund. Maybe a large portfolio of investments so you can kick back and relax. A limited edition watch, maybe. A Patek Philippe. You know, you never actually own a Patek Philippe. You merely look after it for the next generation. But how much of this inheritance do we take after we die? How much more glorious to trade every physical thing we have for the eternal inheritance in heaven, for a citizenship that will never fade, never be destroyed, never be corrupted, never be shunned because of a virus. This promise is given to us in Jesus Christ himself. And no longer will we pine for the things of the world when we set our eyes heavenward. So we have inheritance. But what did God do to enable us to get that inheritance? I continue with the passage in Genesis 15, and like us, Abram is a practical guy. We want practical handles. How do we apply this scripture in our life? And Abram asked God, remember, he's childless, he's landless, and God made him these wild promises, and he asked, oh God, how am I to know that I shall possess it? This is not a lack of faith on Abram's part. If you're in his shoes, it's an honest question. And God answers him with the most cryptic passage in the Bible. God answers Abram with what seems like instructions for animal sacrifice rites. 5 different animals are brought: a heifer or a cow, a female goat, a ram, a turtle dove, and a pigeon. Abram cuts in half the cow, cuts in half the goat, cuts in half the ram. Good thing the birds are lucky, they are left intact. Abram falls asleep, and this smoking pot and flaming torch passes between the cut pieces of meat. What does this all mean? How does this impact the covenant promise? Remember that this is God's response to Abram's question, how am I to know that I shall possess the inheritance of land. The smoke, the fire are a representation of God's presence. So they symbolize God. Remember, this is much like the pillar of fire, the pillar of smoke that the Israelites experience in the wilderness. And the whole ritual of passing between these animal parts is very similar to many ancient Near Eastern rituals for treaty. So in the past, parties to an agreement or a treaty for example, a tribal alliance, or when people swear a very solemn oath to one another, sometimes they bring an animal to the event. They'll cut the poor animal in two, and the both parties to the agreement, the treaty or oath, they will walk between the two halves of the animal. This is done to complete the agreement. This is done to symbolize that if either party breaks this agreement, they will suffer the same fate as the severed animals that they just passed through. Of course, not all agreements warrant cutting in two, and this is left for very serious treaties and agreements. In our modern context, it's more than merely signing on a dotted line. This is more than clicking the I agree button on an online agreement. It is more like those secret society pacts where, you know, the sworn brothers, they make a blood pact, they cut their hand and they shake hands, or they let the blood drip into a bowl and they drink it. Something like that. You get the idea. It's a solemnity of the ritual. We do have another biblical example in Jeremiah 34. And here, the people who have made a covenant passed through a calf that was cut in half. And those that subsequently broke the covenant will be like the severed calf. What a way to go. So this animal rite is not about Abram sacrificing to God, but it's more like sealing a covenant or a promise made between parties. One thing to note in Genesis, it is God who goes through the animal pieces on his own. He went through alone. Abram was made to go in a deep sleep. He couldn't participate. He was a bystander to this whole covenant ritual. And it was God alone who enacted this ritual. And it's important because it is God saying, I would rather be torn apart like these animals than break my promise to you, Abraham. And this we see, the self-sacrificing God that we have. And this we see is the loving God that we have. The good, benevolent, all-powerful God is saying to us, believe in me, believe in my promise. I would sacrifice myself and not break my promise to you. God laid down his right as God to ensure we have an inheritance. Yes, God is good. But to stop at this Old Testament promise, or to only understand these rituals without looking forward to the New Testament and the work of Jesus Christ, would leave us with an incomplete understanding of the Bible and our faith. We explored earlier how the promise of inheritance of land is fulfilled by Jesus, by his coming, by his establishment of the kingdom of God. Without looking forward to see how Jesus has fulfilled this promise of inheritance leads to some very problematic conclusions. Some people insist that the words of inheritance of land is to be fulfilled, literally. And this leads to the problematic conclusion that the Jewish state must be established in Palestine in order for biblical prophecy to be fulfilled. I personally do not believe that to be true. The insistence of literal fulfillment has led to bloodshed in the Middle East, in Palestine, for centuries, for millennia. And we Christians take heart in the fact that the promise of inheritance is fulfilled in Jesus Christ. And Jesus is the one we look to for fulfillment of prophecy, for fulfillment of promise. Jesus is the restoration of Israel. The words of our Savior on the cross, it is finished. And just as Jesus fulfilled the promise of inheritance, Jesus also fulfilled the animal right in Genesis 15. God went through the bodies of the severed animals, saying that I would rather die then break my promise to give you an inheritance. And that's exactly what Jesus did on the cross of Calvary. Jesus would rather endure death on the cross and all the pain and all the suffering that came with the crucifixion to ensure that we have an eternal inheritance, so that you, and you have an eternal inheritance. It is the love of Christ that compelled him to the cross. It is the love of Christ that made him lay aside his majesty, his glory, his power, and his rights for our sake. The God who created life has the right not to die. However, this God gave up his right and humbled himself by being obedient to death on the cross. Jesus' fulfillment of the promise is in his self-sacrifice. His glory is shown in his suffering. And this is our God. How can we not love him? How can we not seek to imitate him? We have taken this long and winding path this morning, and let me quickly summarize where we are. We are asked to imitate Jesus, as Paul said, because we receive our heavenly inheritance and citizenship. The Genesis passage foreshadows this. Abram is given the promise of land as inheritance, and God used the animal right to confirm to Abraham that he will surely fulfill this promise or die. The promise of inheritance is real, and Jesus came to fulfill it. He did this in two ways. One, he expanded the promise of earthly inheritance to a heavenly inheritance in the kingdom. This expanded inheritance goes beyond physical land in Palestine, goes beyond race, beyond Jews, to the Gentiles of the earth, to you, to me. This physical land ceases to have theological significance, and your race ceases to have theological significance, Jew or Gentile. Second, Jesus fulfills the promise of the animal right by dying on the cross to enable us all to receive this heavenly inheritance. The promise is initiated by God, and like Abraham, there's nothing we need to do to claim the promise except to believe in Jesus Christ. And this alone will be counted to us for righteousness. Now we as Christians are called to imitate him because we have Christ in us, his death, his resurrection. We are called to imitate the one we love. We are called to imitate as a child imitates a parent. We are called to imitate because it is the sincerest form of devotion that our mediocrity can pay to the greatness of God. Looking at all this, how then do we imitate Christ? The central theme that ties all this together is Christ's work on the cross. And with all his power and authority, he's willing to lay it down for our sakes. And God is saying, I would rather die and bring all these, my children, into inheritance. In this day and age, we live in a rights-based society. We are governed by laws, by rules, by obligations. And for a large part of my life, I've been studying these laws and rules and obligations. And in fact, I've been advising people what rights they have, how best they can press these rights, how best they can enforce these rights for their own benefit. Our rights are contained in the many documents we see, all the documents we sign, contracts, investment proposals, lease agreements. Our agreements are based on consideration. Consideration meaning, I keep my promise to do something because I have received something in return. It could be a sum of money. It could be a mutual obligation on your part to do something. So what happens when one party does not keep his side of the bargain? Those well-drafted agreements will say, if you don't honor your promise or keep your side of the bargain, you pay me some damages. Or if you don't keep your side of the bargain, I'll sue you and bring you to court. There's nothing wrong with that. It's my right to sue you. You agreed, and you failed to do it. It's not my fault. It's your fault. I have every right to sue you and bring you to court because you agreed to do it. In a society that is increasingly litigious, we like to press our rights, don't we? It could be a very simple thing. When we are driving, and a car in another lane signals and wants to move in our lane, what do? We purposely speed up. It's my right. I have the right of way. Why should I lose my position to you? You can't simply cut in that. You think moving one finger, you can move into my lane? Ah, it's my right. It's my way. Why cannot? It's my right. In some places, we push this personal right to the limit. In countries where they are trying to have legalized euthanasia, the right to choose to die, or to make abortion legal, especially late-term abortion, this slogan is used often. My body, my right. The fetus is in my body. I have the right to do whatever I want with it. Is it my body, my rights in a Christian life? Did Christ lay down all his rights on the cross so that we can press our rights against others? We are confronted with people pressing their rights every day. But how would you feel if someone had a right against you, a right to make a claim against you, but mercifully decides to withdraw that right? I recently read a heartwarming story in the news of how a car accident was amicably resolved. What happened was a taxi driver, he didn't check his blind spot and he turned into the lane. There was an oncoming Porsche and the taxi hit and scratched the front of the Porsche as he was turning, and there were some deep scratches and cracks on the bumper. The car is yellow, if you're wondering. The taxi driver apologized and admitted, "I'm so sorry, it's my fault." But in the end, the Porsche driver told the taxi driver he would only accept one single dollar as compensation for all this damage. He said, "You know, it's not easy for taxi services to make a living during COVID-19. The sports car driver, of course, had every right to make a claim against the taxi driver. It's not his fault. His car was damaged. It's not his fault. But he decided to lay down his rights for someone else. This Lent, we are on a journey of the cross. The journey takes us to the place where Christ himself laid down his right for us. He laid down his majesty. He laid down himself. A common practice during Lent is to fast or to give up something or to deny ourselves as a sign of devotion to God, or sometimes to symbolically replicate the fact that we follow in Christ's path. Some may give up food, maybe a meal a day. Some may be meat. Some may fast from other things. Increasingly, it's creative to fast from Facebook or Korean drama. But can I suggest that in the imitation of Christ, we lay down or give up our earthly rights like Christ did on the cross? Can we fast from rights? We lay down our earthly rights and look upwards to a heavenly inheritance, to a heavenly citizenship. We lay down our rights in imitation and devotion to Christ and in love for others. This laying down of rights may mean different things to different people. Perhaps we're having a long-standing disagreement, or even worse, a feud with a family member or a friend. Can we lay down our rights in this situation? Can we lay down our right to be angry? Can we lay down our right to get even? Can we lay down whatever feelings of being wronged and bury the hatchet? We see families fighting over money, resentment over duties of taking care of an aged parent, a family-run business not doing well, even staying with in-laws. Can we lay down our rights as Christ laid down his life for us in these situations? But you don't know what my spouse did to me. I have every right for a divorce. Sometimes it's humanly impossible. But with God's right help, can we lay down our right? In the workplace, it may be our right to pay our employees the minimum they deserve. That's a market practice. Everyone's doing it. It's okay. But can we lay down our right in the name of charity and generosity? My body, my right. Can we lay down our own right over our bodies in favor of the right of an unborn child, fetus's right to life, even if it's an unwanted pregnancy, even if we know that there's a chance the child will have developmental challenges in the future? And can we advocate for the laying down of these rights? Even on the road, can I set aside my right of way to be more gracious when I'm driving? Christ died for us so that we have a heavenly inheritance, a heavenly reward, a heavenly citizenship. As such, many of our earthly rights we do not need to cling on to. Many of our earthly rights pale in comparison with the greatness of our heavenly inheritance. Let us imitate Christ with all our hearts by laying down our earthly rights with the confidence that our heavenly inheritance is far greater, far more glorious, and far more precious. And in doing so, may we all find God's peace, his rest, and experience his love. Amen.